Today we have a very special event. We call them literally three hot subjects. We use the literal war because it's on climate change, and we managed to get three excellent experts worldwide to discuss issues about climate change, which you know that is very, very hot subject in the present and is very important for our future. Over the years, you can remember that the ICTP started as an international center for theoretical physics. It was very much based on fundamental physics. But over the years, we have expanded in more applied subjects, given our mission to support science in developing countries and then to address the problems of countries from the developing world. And already since the 1990s, we started this group on climate change that has been growing over the years. And so that shows that ICTP has been committed to this problem for already more than two decades. And that is becoming more and more important with time. And and also in the recent years, we have been expanding to other subjects like using low-cost material to address experimental issues that can be brought to the developing countries. Also, now we expanded a new group on quantitative life sciences that includes artificial intelligence and so on. That you know, these are subjects that are becoming more and more important with time. So we're trying to adapt to all the demands and the changes of our times. regarding climate change, I think it's important to address these issues about forecasting of climate at the different levels of weeks, months, years, etc., if possible. And it's crucial for the countries that are, again, the focus of ICTP, which are the countries in the south. And so today we have, as I said, three speakers, Sandrine Bony from the Laboratoire de Meteorologie Dynamique in Paris, Kerry Emanuel from MIT, and Bjorn Stevens from the Max-Planck-Institute of Meteorology in Germany. So each of them will give a 20-minute presentation and then follow up by some questions. The question period will be a bit original. And so since it is original and Adrian has been planning to do it for a while, so I will let Adrian to explain how it will work. Adrian.
I'm Adrian Tompkins, here from the Earth System Physics section. I've been I'm the director on the Climate School this week, so some of the people in the room at this two-week school, which has been organized by, we've got a team of 20 people that are here to teach, and three of those are our speakers today, which I've known for quite a long time. We go back a long way. Sandrine, I met her already two decades ago at the EGU, and we chatted a lot about clouds already, and I actually spent last spring there working closely with the group. Bjorn and I were actually postdocs together way back at Max Planck, and as I said this morning, Kerry actually was the person who grilled me of my PhD defense a long while ago. So I think perhaps you can count today as my revenge in some small way, Kerry. anyway, just super quick, because we have three speakers rather than just one, I thought, and also to enable, there's a lot of people that are watching this on the remote live feed, and there are also some members of the public here that might not feel confident asking a question in English that might want to actually ask the question in Italian. We're actually going to do something a little bit different. We're going to use this system to collect questions in real time, okay? So hopefully you all have a device with you, like a phone or a laptop. If during any of the talks a question occurs to you and you want to pose it, you just simply go to www.menti.com. I actually put it with a D before, which apparently is some Chinese site, so I'm not quite sure what, but I've corrected it. So menti.com, type in this number, and you can simply type in your question. And then Michele and I are going to basically go through these and make a selection of those. And Michele is going to lead the question section at the end. And it can be to one or any of the speakers. They'll be up here at the end. Okay, so I will finish there. And just say thank you all for being here. Thank you, Fernando.
Thank you, Edwin. And of course, if you don't have a device or so, still raising your hands and a question is still allowed. So, okay. Just, okay. Okay, so let's start. So the first speaker is Sandrine Bony. I will read something about her CV, just to embarrass her a little bit. So her main research interest is advancing understanding of the role of clouds and cloud processes in climate sensitivity and in the large-scale circulation of the atmosphere, using a combination of modeling, observational, and conceptual approaches. She is presently co-organizing a large-scale field experiment that will take place in 2020 over the tropical Atlantic near Barbados. The title of the Sandrine's talk is Clouds in the Climate System, Why So Much Uncertainty? So please welcome Sandrine.
And now, can you hear me? Good. So good afternoon, everyone. It's really a great pleasure to be here and to participate in this colloquium with great friends and in front of such a distinguished audience. Adrian proposed me to talk here about one of the hot topics of climate science, which is the role of clouds in the climate system. It's certainly one of the most challenging problems in climate change science, and during the next 20 minutes or so, I'd like to explain to you why clouds are so important for the climate system and why do they introduce so much uncertainty in the climate change prediction problem. And I'd like also to outline a few lines of research where I think, that hopefully will help to reduce some of those uncertainties. If I find the button, yeah. But first of all, just a brief reminder about what clouds represent in the atmosphere. When you look at such a satellite image of the Earth from space, you see the blue planet. It's certainly a planet where there's a lot of water, but it's mostly in the ocean. And there's a little bit of water in the atmosphere, but really the atmospheric water represents a very tiny fraction of the total mass of the atmosphere. And it's mostly in the form of water vapor. And the part of the atmospheric water which is in the form of liquid droplets or ice crystals represents really a tiny fraction of this tiny fraction. So it's really clouds represent a very small part of the atmosphere in terms of mass. But because they interact with the energetics of the atmosphere, they make a world of difference for the climate system. They make a world of difference for us humans as well, who work at the, who live at the surface of the Earth and who like watching clouds, some like painting clouds as well. But really, the reason why clouds are so important for climate is because clouds really are associated with phase changes and they influence the radiative transfer and they affect they are related to turbulence and atmospheric motions. And so they're really part of the energetics of the climate system. When we look at satellite pictures of this kind, we see that the distribution of clouds is very closely related to the large-scale circulation of the atmosphere. We have deep clouds, for instance, in the areas in the equatorial regions where it's not loud enough, where that correspond to the ascending branches of the circulation. We have much less cloudiness in the regions where the air is sinking. And in the mid-latitudes, the clouds very nicely help us visualize as large eddies that are the extratropical storms or storm tracks. But the clouds are far from being just passive tracers of the atmospheric circulation. What has been increasingly demonstrated is that clouds really strongly interact with the atmospheric circulation. And because they're in particular through their influence on radiative transfer. And so, for instance, there is increasing evidence that the radiative effects of clouds can very much affect the position and strength of the rain belts in the tropics, as they can also influence the strength and the position, the latitude at which we have the extratropical storm tracks here. But I will not so much focus on this in this talk. I just remind you that clouds are important for the large-scale circulation of the atmosphere, and therefore they're very important in controlling the spatial distribution of wet and dry areas at the surface of the globe. But one of the reasons why they're so important for climate and climate change is because clouds interact very strongly and modulate very strongly the radiation budget of the atmosphere. You know that the Earth receives energy from the sun, and part of this solar radiation is reflected back to space by clouds, also snow, ice, and the ground. And it emits infrared radiation back to space to maintain a radiation balance. And clouds affect very strongly both the shortwave radiation and the longwave radiation, and therefore they affect very strongly the radiation balance of the Earth, which gives them a strong influence on the control of the global mean surface temperature of our planet. Thanks to satellite observations, we can quantify how much clouds affect the radiation budget, and we can do that thanks to different satellites. Some of them are available. We started to have such observations at the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s. So we can measure the influence of clouds on solar radiation at the top of the atmosphere, and we can show that clouds reflect solar radiation back to space, as you would expect, and all clouds do that, so they have a cooling effect on climate because they contribute to shade the Earth, if you like. But at the same time, clouds also interact with infrared radiation because they absorb radiation and re-emit infrared radiation to space at a much lower temperature, which is the temperature of their cloud top. And this, they contribute to the natural greenhouse effect of the Earth, of the atmosphere, and this is a warming effect for the Earth. So what's interesting to notice is the fact that the relative magnitude of these two effects, the cooling and warming effects of clouds, is very dependent on many different factors. It very much depends on the cloud types in presence, because, for instance, the warming effect of clouds, the greenhouse effect of clouds, very much depends on the cloud top altitude. So it's very strong in the deep tropics here, but it's very small in the regions covered mostly by low-level clouds. It depends also on the cloud optical depth, which depends on how much water there is in clouds. It depends on the extent of clouds. It depends on the microphysical of clouds, on the size of the cloud droplets, of the ice crystals, and so on and so on. So there are really the radiative effects of clouds are very much dependent on which type of clouds are in presence. And in total, what the observations tell us is that on average over the globe, clouds have a cooling effect on the climate. And most of this cooling, or a large part of this cooling, comes from the areas covered by low-level clouds, because it's where the cooling or the shedding effect of clouds is not compensated by the greenhouse effect of clouds. So on average, the clouds cool the Earth, and which means that if there was no clouds in the atmosphere, the Earth would be much warmer. But now the big question is, how will this evolve in the future? You know that there's more and more greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. The Earth is warming because of this. And the question is whether this cooling effect of clouds in a warmer climate will strengthen, in which case it will dump global warming and it will be a negative feedback, or whether this cooling effect of clouds will weaken and then it will amplify global warming. And that's in what in our jargon we call the cloud feedback problem. And it's really been a very challenging question since the very beginning of the climate change studies in the 70s. And we can wonder why it's been so challenging. It's been very difficult to anticipate what could be the sign of the cloud feedback and even more the magnitude of the feedback. And there are many reasons for that. First of all, there's no one cloud on Earth. There are many different types of clouds, many cloud types. And as we've seen, different cloud types have different radiative effects. So if we want to predict the cloud feedback, we need to figure out how the different cloud types will change and how that will affect the radiative effects at the global scale. In addition, the different cloud types are not sensitive to the same factors, and therefore climate change can affect this type of cloud differently from this type of cloud. So it's not an easy problem, and it's very difficult a priori to predict what could be the sign or the magnitude of cloud feedback. Second, we have a few theories now to explain the behavior of clouds and their response to warming, but the theories explain just some particular aspect of the cloud's behavior, or they relate to particular cloud types. We certainly don't have theories for every cloud type and every aspect of the response. Observations. We observe clouds better and better. That's great, but the observational records remain quite limited, quite short. We certainly don't know how clouds were during the Ice Age, for instance. And we have a few decades of cloud observations now, but the time series are quite noisy, and it's still very difficult to extract some trends that could be associated with the evolving cloud warming. So it's difficult, really, to extract information and cloud feedbacks from this. And what we can do much better is to analyze the behavior of clouds on short time scales. But here, the connection between short time scale variations and long time scales and the response of clouds to long-term global warming is really far from being straightforward. So there is no direct analog between short-term variations and long-term climate change. So it's really not straightforward to use observations to anticipate the cloud feedback in the long term. Of course, we have models, climate models, and one of the purposes of climate models is to anticipate or predict what we can't observe yet. And we have many models now, but the problem is that since the very beginning of climate change studies using models, models have always given very different responses to the question of cloud feedbacks. I give you one illustration here of this. Imagine that you have 10 or 15 or 20 models, and you ask each of the models to double the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere and to predict the global warming of the Earth at equilibrium. If you do that, you see that the models predict very different global warming estimates. Some models will predict global warming of 2 degrees, while others will predict a global warming of 4.5 or sometimes even more degrees. And what has been very clearly established for a long time now is that a large part of this spread in the global warming estimates relates to the spread of the cloud feedback predicted by models. In some models, the clouds change very little, are not very sensitive to warming. In other models, they are very sensitive to warming, and the cooling effect of clouds strongly weakens in a warmer climate, which amplifies global warming tremendously. And in those models, really, the climate becomes more sensitive to changes in greenhouse gases, and that's visible as well in the time series of the global mean surface temperature that they predict when you prescribe the evolution of CO2 over the 20th century and over the 21st century. You see that at the end of the 21st century, for a given greenhouse gas scenario, the high sensitivity models predict a much higher warming than the low sensitivity models. So this, really, the response of clouds to warming has been one of the dominant causes of uncertainty, if not the dominant cause of uncertainty, in the prediction of the global warming for a given change in greenhouse gas. And it's been like that for many decades, really. So what can we do to make progress and to approach the problem? Well, we'd like to know whether what the models are predicting is credible, if it's reliable, if there are some models' responses which are more credible than others. And so the way we do it is that we try to decompose the problem into pieces. we try to assess how the clouds change in models for the different aspects of cloud changes, and we try to assess whether this change looks reasonable or not. And to do that, what will we call a reasonable prediction is whether we can relate or connect some of the cloud behavior to some basic physical principle or to some observations or to some, if we think we have a real physical understanding of what's going on and it's basic physics that the models should be able to represent and so on, then we will think that it's a robust piece of the game. But sometimes models do things very differently. We don't really understand why they do that, or we know that this behavior very much depends on uncertain parameters of the clouds and of the models and so on. So in that case, it's really a piece of the puzzle that on which we need to work much more. So I will try to illustrate this in the following. This is a synthesis of different types of cloud changes predicted by models in climate change experiments. In response to warming, even all the models predict a rise in the altitude of high-level clouds. They also predict a poleward shift of the extratropical storms, and they predict a few different other things. What's in red is what all the models do, and what's in gray is what the models do differently. And so there are those changes in the cloud phase, there are changes in cloudiness at low levels, and so on and so on. So how does it translate to the cloud feedback? We can quantify the cloud feedback in models, and what we find is that for the current generation of models, all the models predict a positive cloud feedback, which means that they predict an amplification of global warming due to the change in cloudiness with warming. But you see that the magnitude of this feedback varies a lot across models. So if we want to understand first, there are two things we'd like to understand, is whether this positive feedback is credible, and where the uncertainty in the strength of the feedback comes from. So for this purpose, we can decompose the feedback into different components that relate to different aspects of the change in cloudiness. And then if we do that, there are different types of decompositions that we can do, so if we do that, we can understand that the positive sign of the feedback comes primarily from two things. The first thing is the fact that high clouds get higher. And we think we understand very well why it is so. We can explain this behavior based on thermodynamics and energetic arguments in the tropics. We also have some observational evidence that this is what happens during warmer years. For instance, the cloud tops tend to be higher. And it's supported by a wide range of models, cross-resolution climate models, but also very fine-resolution numerical models and so on. So we think we can be quite confident in this aspect of the cloud response to warming. And this response is associated with a positive feedback because it predicts that the cloud top temperature doesn't change very much in response to global warming, so it increases the temperature difference between the cloud top and the surface, which corresponds to a positive feedback. The other reason why the cloud feedback is positive in models is because most of the models predict a decrease of the low-level cloudiness. And we've seen earlier that the low clouds are the clouds that that exert the largest cooling effect on climate because they don't have a strong greenhouse effect, so they just cool the earth by reflecting sunlight. So the models predict a decrease of low-level cloudiness, but you see that the magnitude of the low cloud feedback varies a lot depending on models, because some models will reduce low clouds much more than others. So there have been a lot of studies during the last decade trying to analyze the origin of this response, and we think that the positive sign of the low cloud feedback is probably we're credible and supported by more and more studies based on observations or high resolution models. So the physical understanding of the processes leading to this is progressing as well. But where there is still a large uncertainty really is regarding the strength or the magnitude of the decrease of the low clouds in response to warming. Because we still don't fully understand what controls the low cloud amount. So that's clearly one subject of research which is very active in the community. We really need to understand what controls the low-level cloud amount. And there are different types of low clouds, again. There are stratus, stratocumulus, trade cumulus, or fair-weather cumulus, if you like. And we're interested in all of those low clouds, but we're interested particularly in those types of low clouds, which are trade cumuli, that occur in the trade wind regions, which are regions of weak subsidence on both edges of their tropical rain belts. And the reason why we're interested in those clouds, it's not that they are particularly big or they're very small, actually, and broken and so on. They are not very spectacular, but they are so ubiquitous over the ocean that even a tiny change in the properties of those clouds can really have a huge impact on the global radiation budget. So we really need to understand what controls their cloud amount and how that this cloud amount depends on environmental conditions. And we have now some ideas about this, about what's important in the large-scale environment, how that affects the cloud properties. But we really need now to quantify these relationships, and we need to test the models at the process level. And this is for this exact purpose that we are organizing a field campaign that will take place near Barbados, so in the trade wind regions, next January, February, to really better understand the physics of this cloud. And so far I've talked about the cloud changes predicted by models in response to global warming. But of course, in the back of our mind, and I'm sure you have the same question in your mind, you can wonder, okay, maybe there are some additional feedbacks which are not reproduced by the models, in none of the models. And so we always have to keep this in mind, that maybe that there's something that all the models are missing. And that's a question we always keep in mind, and if more than ever, I would say, because what recent studies have shown, or suggested at least, is that there could be a potentially additional player in the game of the regulation of climate, which is a special organization of convection, special organization of clouds. So far, we thought that what was important is to predict how much area was covered by clouds and the altitude of clouds and so on. But we were not really aware of the importance of how clouds are spatially organized. And what different modeling studies have shown during the last years is that in simulations, in idealized simulations, where deep clouds like those ones, when they exhibit a stronger clustering or stronger clumping, on average, the atmosphere is much drier, clearer, and it emits more heat to space. So that suggests that a change in the spatial organization of clouds can very much influence the radiation budget. So, of course, we can wonder whether in response to global warming there might be a change in the organization of clouds and whether that could affect the feedbacks. So climate models that I was talking about certainly represent the large-scale organization of clouds, but they don't have the resolution fine enough to represent the mesoscale organization of clouds at a small scale. And so if that is important for the radiation budget, they might miss this effect. But before answering this question, we need first to ask observations whether a change in the spatial organization of clouds can actually modulate the radiation budget in a significant way. So that's something that we've started to look at. What we did is that we used satellite observations from geostationary satellites over a long time series, several decades, and we identified the the deep convective clouds, which are in blue here, and we compute the distance between the different clouds. So in this way we characterize the organization or the spatial distribution of clouds. And we look at how this organization varies with time, from one day to the next, but also from one year to the next, and so on. And we look at whether we see some connection with the radiation budget on average over the tropics. And when we do that, we find that actually there is a strong connection between the two. We find that during the periods where, on average over the tropics, the convection is more clustered, more clumped, then on average the atmosphere is drier, and there are less upper-level clouds, and the radiative budget anomaly averaged over the whole tropics is negative. So that confirms that, at least in observations, there seems to be a radiative impact of changes in the spatial organization of clouds. So then the next question, of course, is whether this convective organization might change with global warming, and whether the climate models reproduce part of this behavior, or whether they miss something important. So that's a very active, lively, exciting subject of research. And actually, the school this week is very much about this. So in conclusion, really, the response of clouds to warming will very much determine many aspects of climate change, the global mean surface temperature, certainly, but also other aspects like changes in the last calculation. Our understanding is that clouds will amplify global warming, but there is still a high level of uncertainty regarding the magnitude of this amplification. And there are still very important sources of uncertainty and a very active subject of research, really, which is the behavior of low-level clouds with warming and the behavior of the spatial organization of convection with warming. And there are, really exciting topics of research, and ICTP is organizing a big event on this topic this week, so it's nice to be here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sandrine, for a very nice talk. We will let all the questions at the end, with having all the speakers as a panel. So I immediately will introduce the next speaker. It's Kerry Emanuel. It's the Cecil and Ida Green Professor of Atmospheric Science at the MIT in the US. And his research specialty is hurricane physics, and he was the first to investigate how long-term climate change might affect hurricane activity, an issue that continues to occupy him today. His interests also include cumulus convection and advanced methods of sampling the atmosphere in aid of numerical weather predictions. Kerry's talk is on will our weather extremes become even more extreme? So let's welcome Kerry.
Well, good afternoon. Everybody hear me okay? Good. So one of the main concerns we have about changing climate is extreme events. We may suffer over the next 50 to 100 years a temperature change of 2 or 3 degrees in the global average. Most of us in this room could barely detect such a small change. That isn't principally the temperature change all by itself. The mean temperature changes is not really what affects human society. We're affected by the extremes. And this is therefore the concern of my talk today. It's a very interesting aspect of actually anthropology that when you look across many different kinds of extreme events, not just meteorological, but geophysical events like earthquakes and volcanoes, societies are fairly well adapted to events that occur more frequently than about once in 100 years. And they're poorly adapted to events that occur less frequently than that. What's magic about 100 years? I assume that it is just several human generations. We remember things that happened to us, obviously. We probably know about what happened to our parents, maybe our grandparents, much beyond that. There's a cultural memory. And so what we're worried about are shifts across that 100-year threshold. That is, if what is today a once-in-200-year event, which is very destructive, becomes a once-in-50-year event, it's happening too fast for human adaptation. That's where we get hurt. So what are the kinds of meteorological changes we're worried about? I would argue that the top four are changes in temperature extremes, not the mean temperature so much. Temperatures, what I'll call hydrology, which is mostly rain or precipitation events. Both too much and too little are of concern. Extreme storms like tropical cyclones, and since we are here in Italy, I'll talk about their equivalent in the Mediterranean Sea, what we call Medicanes, and severe local storms. And if you were paying attention yesterday, that was a very good example of one of those. Okay. So let's talk about temperature first. And I'm borrowing heavily from some work of Steve Sherwood, who Professor Sherwood is here today. And so if you have some contention with what I'm saying, I suggest you direct your remarks to Steve. Here is a map of the peak annual, something called a wet bulb temperature over the planet that we have in the present climate. The wet bulb temperature is, to some approximation, what we actually feel. It's a combination of temperature and humidity. And there's kind of an upper bound on wet bulb temperature that human beings can tolerate. If we had a lot of global warming, much more than is actually being predicted, say 10 degrees, we would see a map of wet bulb temperature, peak annual wet bulb temperature that looks something like that, okay? Much higher in places. And in particular, when we have that, if we were to have that much warming, there'd be a serious challenge to human health because we literally cannot survive, unless obviously we're in nice air-conditioned rooms like this one, if the wet bulb temperature is greater than about 36 degrees C. So if we look at the two distributions on the left, you see in red here, the current climate distribution, probability distribution of wet bulb temperatures at the surface, you notice that this is a steep drop-off. That's for very, very interesting reasons of atmospheric dynamics. Basically, the wet bulb temperature is limited by how warm it is aloft in the atmosphere. The temperatures, especially in the tropics where they're highest, don't change horizontally very much at all. And so the extreme wet bulb temperature is capped by a quantity that doesn't change much horizontally, and that's why you see that cliff. But that restriction doesn't apply in time. If you warm the whole planet, that cap goes up, if you will. And so you see on the right-hand side, this distribution is shifted here, and this dashed line is essentially the human adaptability limit for temperature. So one concern about warming is that as you warm the planet, the warmest temperatures begin to become challenging for human health all by themselves. That's a probability. It's a probability. This is a probability distribution of temperatures. Yeah. Hydrology, there's something very elementary about climate physics, which we've understood for decades, is that as you make the climate warmer, hydrological extremes of both kinds actually become more probable. That is, you experience an increase in the probability both of very heavy rainfall and of prolonged drought. And I want to explain to you a little bit about the physics of this. This is something very elementary and elegant. It doesn't require very large climate models, for example, to tell you this. So let's start with one interesting constraint on the whole global annual precipitation. So this is very interesting. The total amount of condensation of water vapor in the atmosphere that one has around the world has to, in the long run, be balanced by radiative cooling. That is, the latent heat of vaporization that's released to the atmosphere when water condenses is compensated in the long run by infrared radiation to space. So there's a very tight relationship between global mean, annual mean precipitation and the radiative cooling of the atmosphere. Well, the radiative cooling is controlled by radiation physics, which are related to water vapor and so on. The bottom line is as you warm the planet, the radiative cooling rate increases, but increases quite slowly, only a few percent. And so we've known for a long time that global warming is not going to have very much effect on the global mean, annual mean rainfall of the planet. It just can't do that for physical reasons. So we have the makings of what might seem to be a paradox here, and that is that the water vapor concentration of the atmosphere increases nearly exponentially according to the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, if you know what that is. It's a thermodynamic limit on the saturation vapor pressure of water in the atmosphere. That goes up very fast with temperature. And so the water going up into clouds, and I'll explain this a little bit more in a minute, the water vapor going up into clouds goes up pretty quickly with temperature. And that would suggest that the intensity of rainfall goes up pretty quickly. So we have what seems like a paradox, that the intensity of rainfall, that is how hard it's raining, when and where it's raining, goes up fast, but the total global precipitation goes up slowly. And the way nature resolves that seeming paradox is to have it rain less frequently. And you might think of frequency as both in space and time. All right. So in an average place, it rains harder when it rains, but it does not rain as often. And that spells a bigger problem both with floods and with drought. And this is, again, an elementary, very robust aspect. Models do show this, but we don't need models to teach us that. Now, if we go into a very nice sort of classical, simple, elementary, theoretical climate state called radiative convective equilibrium, or RCE, we can see this very easily. We have one kind of balance in the clear air. That is, if we look at an atmosphere like the photograph that Sandrine just showed you, filled with cumulus clouds, there's a lot of clear air between the clouds. The mass of air going up inside the clouds must equal the mass of air coming down in between the clouds. But the latter is limited, is rate limited, because by the radiative cooling rate. That air is subsiding, it warms by compression, and that has to be compensated by radiative cooling. So we have a relationship. If you tell me the radiative cooling, theta is something called a potential temperature. It's an effective temperature of the atmosphere. It increases with height, this particular kind of temperature. And the rate at which it increases is called a lapse rate of temperature, or this whole term is called a stability term. And so we can calculate the convective mass flux. So that's radiative cooling. That's the static stability. And so if we want to know how the convective mass flux changes as the climate warms, we want to know what those two things do. Well, I just told you a minute ago, the radiative cooling of the atmosphere increases slowly. But the static stability increases, for reasons I don't want to go into here, with the Clausius-Clapeyron relationship. It increases much faster. So the convective mass flux must go down in radiative convective equilibrium, and it does in model experiments where we crank up the temperature of the system or put carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The mass flux goes down. There's less mass going up in cumulus clouds per unit area. But on the other hand, the air going up into the bases of each of these clouds has a lot more water vapor in it because it's warmer. This is Clausius-Clapeyron. And so what we call the rainfall intensity scales as the product of that water vapor concentration, I call it Q star here, times W, the vertical velocity going up in the clouds. So vertical velocity times water vapor gives you the local intensity of rainfall, okay? Now, so if we know what happens to Q star goes up exponentially with temperature. What about W? This remains a little bit of a mystery in the field of meteorology. We know from numerical experiments dating back two decades or so that that doesn't tend to change very much, just empirically. And more recently, we've various groups, some of which involve me, found that, oddly enough, the updraft speed in your average tropical convective cloud scales with the terminal fall speed of raindrops. If you're a physicist, you might think that's very remarkable. If you're an atmospheric scientist, you think that's even more remarkable. It's a very strange relationship, but we observe it in models. We have different ways of rationalizing it. I would argue we don't have a generally accepted theory for this. But if you accept the empiricism there, the rainfall intensity therefore scales with Q star because W doesn't change very much. So we have the same problem. The mass flux goes down, but the intensity of rain goes up. So just as in the global average problem, it's going to rain harder when it rains, but rain less frequently. That may also mean that areas of the globe that are generally wet might get wetter, and places that are dry might get drier. That's another way to realize this constraint from atmospheric physics. And so in RCE state also, we would deduce that the fractional area covered by updrafts decreases, and in models it does. So we're beginning to see this in data. So this is just a graph showing a sort of a trend in very heavy kinds of rain. It's actually rainfall days of 2 inches or more, which is very heavy rain. And you can see that there's an upward trend. Whether that's really all due to the phenomenon of global warming is not known, but it's consistent with what one would predict theoretically. Now let's move on to my specialty, which are tropical cyclones and their Mediterranean cousins. And here there's been a lot of work going on for a long time about it. One thing that happens when you put greenhouse gases in the atmosphere is it increases the theoretical upper bound on the intensity of tropical cyclones, a quantity we call the potential intensity. It's a very well-defined, robust quantity. It simply is taking advantage of the fact that a tropical cyclone is a heat engine, extracts heat from the ocean. There's a strong thermodynamic disequilibrium between the ocean and the atmosphere and the tropical climate. And converts that heat to wind energy, which is dissipated in the atmospheric boundary layer. Just by knowing that, one can derive an expression for this potential intensity. And we know that as you put greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, this intensity goes up. Basically, you have more downwelling infrared radiation from the greenhouse gases. To compensate for that, the ocean must maintain a higher evaporative potential. That evaporative potential is strongly related to this potential intensity. So we've been predicting for more than 3 decades this would happen. But on the other hand, there is also a thermodynamical inhibition to the generation of tropical cyclones. That goes up too. And so we have a bit of a climate change that's working in 2 different directions. But we do know that given that there is a tropical cyclone, for the same reasons I alluded to, the amount of rain produced by it will go up very quickly with Clausius Clapeyron because the amount of water vapor in the air is large. So if you survey the community of climate scientists who work on hurricanes, you will see, in fact, there's a consensus that just appeared, that there's a strong consensus that the incidence of very strong tropical cyclones, which are up against this thermodynamic limit, will go up. And that rainfall will become heavier, so therefore flooding, both salt water and fresh water, by these storms will become more problematic, but there's not much consensus about what happens to weak storms in this. So if you're interested, there is a very recent review, literally just appeared last week or something like that, in the Bulletin of the American Meteorological Society. This is just a graph showing how this potential intensity, it's actually expressed as a wind speed in meters per second, goes up when you do various things to the climate system, like increase the solar constant in magenta color there, or increase the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. One interesting thing is if you get a lot of CO2 in the atmosphere, this speed limit on hurricanes actually saturates. It does not go up indefinitely, even though the surface temperature does go up. And when we run specialized models of tropical cyclones into the future, assuming that greenhouse gases continue to increase, we see this increase in a metric of the total amount of energy dissipated by tropical cyclones on the planet. This is, if you run different models, this has actually been run using six models. The shading represents the scatter among those six models. Other kinds of ways of dealing with this problem don't produce such large increases, or in some cases, larger increases. If we look at actual climate data, or something called a climate reanalysis, we can actually very easily calculate this thermodynamic bound on tropical cyclone wind speed. And this is an observed trend from 1979 to 2018 from one such climate reanalysis. I'm showing you only that linear trend when its p-value is less than 0.05. That is when it's highly likely that it's a statistically significant trend. And so you see in most parts of the world that there's a trend, a significant trend at all, it's upward. And it's upward at a rather significant rate. So the big tropical cyclone producing areas of the Atlantic, the Eastern Pacific, the Western Pacific, and the Indian Ocean. And look at the Mediterranean up in the left-hand corner, okay, are showing increases. And when we look at tropical cyclone data, it's a very problematic data set. We don't do a very good job measuring these storms. But if we look at linear trends in those, as a function of how strong the storms are in the first place, so on the bottom axis, we see the sort of peak intensity that storms reach. And on this axis is the linear trend. And the blue shading sort of shows you the scatter, if you will, in that trend, or the uncertainty of that trend. You can see that the weaker storms don't exhibit any upward trend, but as you get to higher and higher intensities, you do see an upward trend in intensity. So consistent with the theory of potential intensity, real storms are responding to the lifting of this cap by showing an increase in the high intensity storms. I wanted to say something again more generally about why the extremes matter by showing you this graph. This is a curious graph, and it pertains to the damage done by hurricanes hitting the United States. I use this not specifically because it's the United States, but as a means of illustration. This is actually done by coupling a hurricane model with a physical model of damage to structures like buildings. A long story behind this. I don't need to tell it to you now. This is the probability density of damage on this log scale in US dollars. So 9 is 10 to the 9th dollars, or $1 billion per storm, okay? And this is the probability averaged over a long time. The blue is from the current climate, and the green is a projection for a future climate. They're very similar looking, okay? You see a very slight decrease in the probability of low damage and a slight increase in the probability of high damage. Okay, so what? Doesn't look like much. Now let's display the same data a little bit differently. I'm going to multiply the probability density by the damage itself. When you do that, if you integrate across from left to right, you get the total damage done by all storms. And you can see, so the area under these curves is proportional to the total damage, that this slight decrease didn't matter at all because these storms weren't doing much damage. This matters a lot. This is a classic example of tail risk. We're concerned about the tails of distributions, not the means in quantities like that. That's really the most important message I have to convey in this talk. More than double the amount of damage by that seemingly slight. And this is another example of rare events that are very damaging becoming a little less rare. That's a big problem for society. So this is the same thing for hurricane rainfall. This is a chart I show to insurance companies. This is storm total rainfall. This is a measure of frequency. It's called the return period. It's literally the inverse of the annual probability of the event. The blue is for the current climate. The red is for the end of the century. And the green is for now. And this is for Harris County in Texas, where Hurricane Harvey occurred. And this is Hurricane Harvey's rainfall. So it goes from a once in 2,000 or 3,000 year event to something more like a once in 600 year event by the end of the century, but look where it already is. but insurance companies are using these statistics to calculate insurance rates. Now, if any of you are paying property insurance, you don't want to hear me say this, okay? I'm telling insurance companies, the climate has already changed. It's not about the future only, it's about now. And here is a Mediterranean hurricane, which we named Medicanes. They occur under somewhat different conditions, but physically they're the same kind of storm. This one had a name. It was called Zorba, I guess because it went into Greece. Here it is striking the Peloponnesian region of Greece just last September. And we did a very extensive study of these storms. This shows using 30 different climate models. This is quite a massive study, that the frequency of Medicanes, where there's hatching, there's lots of agreement among the 30 models, actually in many regions goes down with warming, except in the far western Mediterranean and in the Black Sea. But if you look at the frequency of the intense storms with more than 60 knots of wind, those go up in most places, including here. Okay, that's what we... finally, let me finish with the phenomenon of severe local storms. These are strong thunderstorms that produce strong winds, like we had here yesterday, hail, and in some places, tornadoes. Collectively, they do a lot of damage. Why should we worry about this? Well, if you were here yesterday, trying to get here yesterday, you know that it was at least an inconvenience for you that there were severe storms. It's much worse than that, of course. They do a lot of damage. And if you're not horrified as a European by the damage these storms do, I want you to read this headline. It's something that happened in France. That's why you should be worried. So we're only beginning to understand how these storms respond to climate theoretically. And one of the quantities we are interested in, something called the convective available potential energy, tells us theoretically how strong updrafts can be in thunderstorms, and that's related to their severity. Very recently, we've understood something that we didn't understand before, that you get very large values of this quantity when you take dry air that's been formed over deserts, such as North Africa, for example, and move it over moist soil. We used to think it was necessary to move it over moist air. That turns out not to be very important. The important thing is to move it over wet soil. It's very interesting, theoretically, but because we've understood that, we actually can make sort of an upper bound theory for this cape. And I'm not going to go through this in great detail for you, but it depends on how warm the soil is. It depends on the soil moisture, the net insulation, and even the surface wind speed. But let me move to the bottom line in the interest of time. Not only does that increase fast as the climate warms, but another quantity called convective inhibition, very parallel to hurricanes, by the way, which is a measure of the thermodynamic limitation to starting a thunderstorm in the first place, also increases as you warm the climate. So if this theory is correct, we would actually expect fewer severe thunderstorms. But the ones that do occur could be more violent. And so this is just a graph showing this quantity as a function of the surface temperature for different values of how wet the soil is. And this is something that the severe storm community has only started to realize, that soil wetness, and no, the ocean won't do, by the way. You have to have a strong diurnal cycle. This is just literally the wetness of the soil. You get only really get these severe storms over land. And we have just started being able to measure soil moisture with satellite. This is a snapshot showing the wetness of soil around the world measured by satellite. So this is coming at just the right time for people interested in this theory, okay? We can start to evaluate in real time, help to evaluate this upper limit on CAPE. And I think I won't go into the details there. So let me summarize. Climate warming implies high temperature extremes that are closer to the human endurance limit. I should say there's a lot of human there's been a lot of exhibited human adaptation to high temperatures. When it gets warm, we react. We do take measures to cool off. That works up to a point. Okay, it works up to the sort of threshold temperature that's dictated by our body temperature ultimately. And the problem is we move closer to that limit. Hydrological extremes, floods and droughts, are both expected to increase, and models do show that as well. But I want to emphasize, we don't need complicated models to understand that basic point. This is probably the worst aspect of the whole problem, and if you talk to anybody high up in a military establishment, it's what the military is worried about, because they know historically that this is all about shortages of food and or water, and shortages of food and water historically have led to political destabilization, war, big migration pressures, and so forth. So this probably is the worst aspect of it. Incidents of intense hurricanes are expected to increase, and they're expected to rain a lot more, but we might see a decrease of weak storms. And this is just very recent theory, so we have more work to do, but the frequency of severe local storms may actually decline, but their severity may increase. And so we might see more violent tornadoes and larger hailstones in the storms that we do have. We need to also pay attention to changing patterns of soil moisture, which is a quantity climate scientists haven't always worried about too much. So that is a very quick summary of what to me is a very interesting and practically important field. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kerry. So we continue for the next speaker. It's Bjorn Stevens. He's the director of the Max-Planck-Institute for Meteorology in Hamburg, in Germany. His research blends modeling, theory, and fieldwork to help articulate the role of aerosols, clouds, and atmospheric convection in the climate system, with pioneering contributions to both understanding and modeling of mixing and microphysical processes and their impact on the structure and organization of clouds. Bjorn's talk is entitled Beyond Global Warming. So let's welcome Bjorn.
Make this work. Okay, so it's a great pleasure to be here, and I wanted to thank Adrian, where is he, right there, for organizing really a fantastic meeting on a very timely theme. And I will do my best to keep up with the last two speakers, who I admire quite a bit, and maybe you'll notice that through the talk. A long time ago, people thought of the world like this. So this is one of the very first maps that has been recreated based on historical records. It's a map of Ekatius, and you can see he was from this region of Turkey, which is in the middle of the map here. Miletus. So this is when the Persian culture was sort of shifting into Western culture, and it was before the sort of classical Greek period, 600 BC or so. And at that time, the world was mostly land, a big blob of land with water in the middle. And climate was something that you moved to. So the word climate was the word that people used to describe everything that changed when you went through a translation. So if you moved yourself, like this young woman up here, to a different place, climate was the word you used to describe what was different. So for most of human history, climate was something that you changed by moving yourself. And normally people did this somewhat blindly. So here, climate's something that you change by moving. It was blind. People would migrate, and things would change. And they would notice some of the things that happened frequently fairly quick, and the things that happened infrequently they would notice somewhat slower. And she's blindfolded because you really have no idea what you're getting into at that time. So if you go back not so long ago, maybe 1,000 years ago, or 1,500 years after that map, there is some evidence that there was a slow climate change around the year 1000. And some evidence of this was put together in a famous paper by, I think it's Horace Lamb in 1965. And one of the pieces of evidence he had was this map of archaeological evidence of a wine culture. So here we can follow up on Kerry's point about grapes being important. And there is some evidence that where you have wine, it had to be warmer. And wine is also a magnet for people, because I think all intelligent people know to follow wine. Here's an example of one. So this is our previous speaker who had been migrating to the wineyards of France. And so it's good evidence, Horace knew, that if there was wine, the people would follow and the weather was good. So climate change in the past. If you look back his reconstruction, he looked at the reconstruction from the wine, and these are temperatures. These are annual temperatures here and summer and winter temperatures, and the curve shows time as you go from left to right. And what you see around the year 1000 is what people call this medieval warm period or the medieval climate anomaly. And so climate wasn't just what happened by moving. In the background, climate was always also changing, or so we think. So here, for reasons that people dispute, there seems to be a cycle of warming around the year 1000, followed by a period of cooling that people think of as the Little Ice Age. And with this cycle of warming, we saw the growth of the wine culture in Normandy, England, and inflow of people into these sort of Norman lands. So you can think of the Norman lands as England, and then from the coast of Normandy up to Denmark, where we would have what some people call the Frisian culture. So in the year 1000, this gradually changing climate made some places a bit more habitable, perhaps, and this led to people moving northward and moving coastalward. You can see this now actually in modern reconstruction. So this is just a recent paper, which looks again, this is time running from left to right. So this is the year 1000 in the current era right here. And these are different regions. So this would be Eastern North America and Western Eurasia. Eastern Eurasia down here and Western Eurasia there, sorry. That's Western North America on the top. But the main point is it seems in these records to be more pronounced in the Atlantic sector, but there was a period of time where the climate was warming around the Atlantic sector. You saw migrations northward, you saw flowering of cultures, and then you saw the retreat of temperatures. And these differences here, look, this is the modern era right here. So these were a little bit smaller in these regions, maybe 1 to 1.5 degrees compared to in the same region now over the last 50 years, perhaps 2 degrees. And they happened much more slowly, but it conditioned how people behaved. So where I come from, I was thinking about, well, come from is an exaggeration because I don't really come from anywhere, but where I am now, where I live now is in Hamburg in the north of Germany, and it's not far from this Danish coast. And this is what the Danish coastline looked like in the year 1200. So in the back of our heads, we have this idea that to first order, climate was something you moved to. But in the background, climate's changing. That might have influenced how long you stay. And what was happening in the areas that you moved to. So this is at the middle of this medieval warm period where the climate was warmer, and you saw a really growth of this peat culture in this region. So here at this time, what happened was people were exploiting peat, so buried carbon, using it for fuel, and then turning the areas into agriculture. And so they built up this wonderful dike culture where they protected themselves against the sea, the North Sea. They used the fuel of the stored peat. But what happened was that changed their world, and it led to a period of strong flooding, and it's unclear. So this is a medieval painting here from the St. Elizabeth's floods in 1421. But some of the early floods in these regions here go back to the 13th century. There's a flood in 1262 called the St. Marcellus flood. I don't know if some of the German-speaking people or Danish-speaking people could say it better, this grote mandrink. It's sort of like the big man drink, which means the huge drowning. So people moved into these areas. The climate seemed hospitable. But then as the medieval warm period came to an end, as the people changed the land surface around them, the places became much less hospitable. And there was a sequence of floods as the climate cooled. Whether it had anything to do with the climate cooling is unclear. It could be that as the climate cooled, the agriculture was less productive. People kept up the dikes a little bit less. And so the defenses that were always there just were weakened. Or it could have been that there was a shift in a climate zone as the temperature cooled, and that led to these large floods. But one, you know, what's not disputed is that you entered a period where you had very strong floods, breaching of dikes, and in one flood alone, there's an estimate. The estimates range from 50 to 200,000 people drowned in a single flood in this 1262 St. Marcellus flood. So what it led to was a great decline of the people in that area, and it changed the shape of the landscape. So if you look at that part of the landscape now, this is the map in 1250, and this is a drawing that was done in the late 1600s, and this is what it looks like today. So if you went here, there's many of these areas here which don't exist anymore because they're just washed away. There's whole towns that are underneath the sea. The point, and this is before modern climate change. This is the point I want to make too is that the vulnerability of people here might have been influenced by the slowly changing backdrop of climate change. It might have been influenced by their own impact on the local climate system, because people were doing things to the land in those areas which made the land sink. As they took up the peat, the land compacted. So the land actually was sinking much more than the sea was rising. There are some arguments that the sea wasn't even rising. Or, like I said, the storms just changed. Okay, so this is an example of climate change and how it influences human civilizations. It's very local. So it's just one little part of sort of Normandy Europe, and there the big challenge for people was dealing with floods, and it changed the way it changed their picture of the world. If we go forward, we can look at these same floods, and this is where I'm moving towards Hamburg. So it's a little bit to the south of that image. If I go back to this point here, Hamburg is sort of down here. It's not that far away. And you can look at these North Sea floods. What happens is a big storm comes into the North Sea when the winds are just pointed in the right way, and it just channels the high water in a storm surge onto the land, and it breaks through the dikes, and it floods the villages. And this has also been the case in Hamburg, which is about 160 kilometers upriver of the North Sea. And this is a time series that Han van Stork put together, which goes back a few hundred years from St. Pauli, a district in Hamburg, and it shows floods over the years. And here, what these are the high water marks. So I think it's 5 meters, and that's 6 meters, and you see over time. And everywhere there's a star, there was a dike breach. And when a dike was broken, then what happened is lots of people usually died. And then they would reinforce the dikes. And so a famous flood was in 1962. And what you see in 1962, 347 people died during a big dike breach. And that caused them to build bigger dikes. And then they built even bigger dikes. And since then, there's been no stars. So you can see this picture of adaptation to climate change, that people sort of iterate their way to adaptive cultures if they have the resources to do so. If they don't have the resources to do so, they perish or they migrate away. But something else that you see in here is that the floods used to always be this big. You know, they'd go up here to sort of 5.5 meters. But recently, in the last 25 years, you see a real increase in strong floods. And the tendency would be to say, okay, here we take a place like Hamburg, and we take the thing that we care about in Hamburg. Every place has their own little climate vulnerability, you could call it. And in Hamburg, it would be the flooding. And so you take the thing that's important for Hamburg, and you look, well, actually, this is increasing a lot. And is it because of climate change? Sea level rise? Maybe the storms are becoming more intense because they're... the arguments that Kerry talked about, the wet getting wetter, the dry getting drier? Or is it because they've been building dikes? And it turns out, actually, the last answer is the reason. The floods haven't been getting bigger because the weather has been changing so much. The floods have been getting bigger because we've been building dikes. And so the dike building deficit here, and this is shown in this time series here, this is the difference between the high water at the mouth of the Elbe, Cuxhaven, and Hamburg, 150 kilometers up the river. And you would expect that not to change, the relative difference. If you have a stronger storm, it would make high water at the mouth of the Elbe be larger, but also inland. But as you protect the land with larger dikes, as the storms wash on shore, they can't spread out across the landscape. You don't want them to. People are living there. And so you channel the water. As you change the shape of the river for the shipping, you also channel the water. And so most of this, and that's what you see here, this is a big dike building after this 1962 flood. They built much bigger dikes, and what you see is this rapid increase in the difference between the high water in Hamburg versus the high water in Cuxhaven at the mouth. And this difference here is about 50 or 60 centimeters. At the same time, global sea level has been rising. And if you look at that same period, the global sea level rise would explain a rise in the floodwaters that would happen both in Cuxhaven and in Hamburg, so it wouldn't change this relative position. But it would change the water levels in Hamburg by maybe a fifth of that. So people's effect on their local environment has changed the shape of climate much more strongly still than the black background. Even now, where climate is changing quite rapidly, that's a small effect if you look in Hamburg in terms of flood potential. But it's becoming something that's competing with the local effects. So the one way you could look at it, at climate is, up until now, mostly we changed our climate by things we did locally. So we would move to a place, we would degrade the place. But now we're acting on a climate system globally, and these global changes are beginning to be competitive with the local changes. And so here I put it in some words here. I say, in the past, climate was something that you changed by moving, or you changed the impacts of an unchanging climate by how you changed your environment. But in some ways, there was a reciprocity there. You know, what you did there, how you moved, what you did affected you. And this sometimes initiated cycles of degradation, adaptation, migration. People would die, people would move. So you could say from this point of view, climate's always been changing, and some of the biggest things that we've had happen to us are the things that happened to us locally. So what's new? What's the big deal about climate change? And I think the big deal about it, one is that it's not something we're moving to, it's something that's coming to us. So it's a new world that's happening in time. And because it's happening in time, it's not something that we can go back on. So when climate change is a translation in space, you can just go back to where you were if you don't like it on the, you know, up in Northern Europe. But now, as you change climate globally, you can't really reverse it so easily. So our influence is global. And the other thing is that because it's global, the way we change the climate system globally can have effects remotely, so we affect the climate of people who have nothing to do with that. But here's the other thought, is if we affect the climate far away, can that change our climate here? So it's become a much more complicated and intertwined problem than just thinking about the local context. And the other thing that's different now compared to when that girl wandered up across to North Europe was that we have science, which could help us reduce the need to iterate. And so the second part of this talk, what I will try to show you is how the role for science in helping us deal with these problems. So first, this music. Listen to the background. And the foreground has this boom, boom. But the background kind of grows on you. Oh, is this the theme here, the horns? Or is this? But you see the background going. Picking up. And then you'll see it will overwhelm the story. And we'll give it a few more seconds. So I played that music because I was trying to visualize or imagine climate change as sound. And in my mind, in the past, it was this very low background sound that might have conditioned how people behave, and things were happening in between. And then it sort of moves, changes its tone, and then overwhelms the whole picture. And so I asked Sandrine if she could think of some music that conveyed that, and so that was her suggestion. So that's a picture of climate change, which I hope gives you a different framework to think about how we think about global climate change. So the point is, we have global climate change. It's not just local climate change. We have global climate change, and this is a way I like to illustrate it with this figure here, which is a figure of the global temperature change that was predicted right at the height of the last cooling in 1975, where people were talking about the return of the ice age. A man named Wally Brooker said, wait a second, you know, if we're right about CO2, it's not going to be an ice age, it's going to start warming. And he drew this curve of how he imagined, based on theoretical models, simple ones, how the temperature would change, which would go up here. And what you find is that it more or less, the red lines are how the temperature has changed. So climate change isn't, you know, this is something that people have been saying for 40 years. People have made predictions about. The predictions have been fulfilled. It's here, but what does it mean? So if we go back to the storms, and this is this, if we go back to the storms in the North Sea, these are storms, this is a global model where we can calculate what the impact of the storms are. So we can say the world warms, how will these storms change, the ones that flooded Friesland? And so here I'm gonna show you a little bit what a global model like this does, if it animates for me. So this is just a visualization of how we calculate with a global model at 14-kilometer global grid spacing. And you see these storms as they move off the east coast of the United States, and they turn into these wonderful swirls which crash into Europe. And sometimes when the winds become, as the winds, the shading is the clouds and the winds are the vectors, and the area that I was talking about before is right in here. I don't know if you can see that. And when the winds pile up here, which are westward, this really affects the storm. So the flooding in Hamburg depends very much on where the storms crash into the land, how strong the storms are, if they're stationary. So that depends on many, many details. And you could say, well, this is great, because now we can calculate with a global model, we can calculate how will the storms change, how will flooding in Hamburg change, and we can use our scientific knowledge to prepare us to adapt more effectively in the future. So people have made calculations like this for a while, and these are some that we did, and you can calculate what will happen to these sorts of storms. And what you find is, as Kerry was saying, I can go through this very quickly here, but the strongest storms increase with this Clausius-Clapeyron, the 7%. The average storms increase with the energy budget. So you can say, well, actually, the amount of rainfall from the strongest storms will increase quite strongly. But the storms themselves, this is a storm-centered distribution of the storm pressure. And the point of this figure is that the left and the right figure is the difference between a storm now and a storm in 75 years. And the figures look exactly the same. So there's no evidence from these sort of calculations that the storms will change, they'll become any stronger. The same storms will carry more rain for reasons we talked about. And here you can't really make it out, but this is, if you look at this figure here, you can see the tracks of storms. So we're looking down from the North Pole. This is the west coast of North America, and this is Europe. And what you can do is you can calculate the tracks of storms, and you can say in this model, do the storms move poleward, do they move southward? Because even if the storms get stronger, if they're hitting Norway instead of Hamburg, then that makes a big difference on how you plan your local adaptation. And there's some evidence, actually, in these calculations that the storms move southward. So you could say to yourself, well, all is good and perfect. We have these models. We can calculate how the storms will change in the future, right? So we know how the large scale will change, and then the storms just are the consequence of that. It turns out there's a little glitch in this argument, and this is the glitch of the extremes, is that the storms in the North Atlantic don't just depend on the North Atlantic. And here's a paper that was written in 1986 or so, and it makes the case that if you change the behavior of storms like this in the deep Pacific a little bit, it affects the large-scale circulation in a way that changes the storminess in the Atlantic. So the argument was that the structure of the storms in the Atlantic, if they're a little bit further north or if they're a little bit further south, are conditioned by the large-scale circulation by what happens deep in the West Pacific. So now I hope you're seeing a little bit of the contrast with that earlier picture of local climate change and things that happen locally, is that when we have global climate change, we can be changing things in parts of the world that we're not thinking about at all. And these can come back through what this is showing is regions of high and low pressure. Here it's stream function or patterns of winds, and how a little change here in this little box here has translated into a pattern of circulation changes which more or less follow this green arc. So this is this what people like to call a teleconnection pattern from the West Pacific through North America into the North Atlantic. And so the argument there is that a little change in storms like this in a far, far, far part of the world that's far away from us can influence how the storms that I just showed in the last simulation will behave. Here's another example of these sorts of regions. Now, the problem with this is that we don't understand how storms in this region of the world, and this goes back to Sandrine's talk, really behave. So when we're modeling the climate system, we're really good at modeling the parts of the climate system which are sort of in the mid-latitudes and towards the poles, and which are these large swirling motions which I showed in the last movie. What we're very bad at modeling is the vertical exchange of energy in the deep tropics, how energy gets from the surface of the Earth into the atmosphere affects the distributions of clouds and the heating in the deep tropics. And now I want to bring you to another nice little picture from our talk, and this is because the hard part of the story is deep in the tropics, where we don't know how small changes in the flow influence the large scale. And there was another young person a long time ago who was wondering about that. And the thing I find remarkable about this picture here is there's this quote, somebody in high school was thinking about this. There's this wonderful quote there that says, "And big worlds make little worlds, and so on to viscosity." It's a famous quote from Lewis Fry Richardson that really talks about how large-scale motions break down into small-scale motions, and they end in the heat bath. And the problem with this quote, and you can see this person is quite concerned about this here, the problem with that quote is that it creates this picture like that simulation that I showed you at the very, you know, a few slides ago, is that that we know somehow what the large scale is, and then we just have to calculate our way down to the small scales. And Kerry mentioned this idea of wishy, and here I drew it here. The sun is heating the ocean, and a wind suddenly blows. The wind blows and evaporates moisture, which forms clouds, which makes rain, which then makes the wind blow again. So you have this wonderful ability of the system to self-organize from small scales in ways that we don't understand very well at all, and it might matter for the climate very far away. So with global change, we can change the behavior of parts of the system that we don't understand in ways that will then influence the parts that we do understand. And so I think here, this is Kerry Emanuel again. I'm sorry, Kerry, I had to honor you with this, and I bugged his wife for old photos because I thought it would make it more fun. And here he's complaining, but Professor Richardson, little worlds make big worlds, and that's what sets intensity. So it's not just this idea of information flowing down from large scale to small scales, but how do the small scales actually feed information back up? But I wanted to say that the problem of the information going back up is this crucial problem for our climate system. And here's Sandrine correcting Kerry, saying, but it's not just onward to intensity, it's onward to opacity. Because if you look at our lack of knowledge of small scales, what this is a picture of the globe. And the globe here, in four instances, just show different realizations of how these small scales are working. And you get four completely different planets. So the colors are rainfall. And what it shows is that in these four slightly different circumstances, then one of the worlds has rainfall which is very intense in very clustered areas, and in other areas it's fairly uniformly distributed around the Earth. And this ends up affecting the opacity, the ability of the planet to lose heat to space. And it depends on how you represent these small-scale processes in the tropics. So this is radiative convective equilibrium, the theme of the school. It's a paradigm for how the global tropics behave, and it's exceptionally sensitive to how we model these small scales. And it might have some surprises, so I'm going to skip ahead to this next slide here and give you an example of this global tropics when we run a model which has this sort of uncertainty in it. And it shows a picture of the global tropics when we just run it in present-day conditions. This is temperature over 1,000 years. It varies by a few tenths of a degree. And then if we halve the CO2, so a negative doubling, if we halve it, the temperature goes down. But if you look at the character of the time series, it looks very similar. And then if we double CO2, the temperature goes up about 2 degrees, and the time series looks similar. And if we increase CO2 again, it goes up, and the time series seems similar. So our model is behaving fairly reliably, like we think the world behaves. But if we push it a little bit more, we suddenly get into this really ridiculous behavior in the model, is that you get these huge swings in the surface temperature field. Instead of going up and down just little bits, you get these enormous 10-degree switches in global climate that persist for decades. And in the model, that happens for fairly simple reasons. It happens because of this large-scale convective aggregation that can happen in this type of model. So you get, when you have a warm enough temperature, you get a lot of stability, which allows low clouds to form where it's not convecting, which cools the planet down until you reduce the stability, and then it goes back again. So this is a bit of an absurd example of how a model of the global tropics can be susceptible to large-scale changes that we didn't expect. And it should make us worry a little bit when we think about how we're moving into the future. So what I wanted to say, if I come back to my last slides here, is that climate used to be something that we would move through to and experience its changes, adapt to them, or perish. In a modern society, we would like to think that we can predict what these changes would be. Up until now, it's been very hard to predict what the changes will be because they're deep in the tropics using parts of the atmosphere that we don't understand very well, and we haven't had the tools to do so. So what we would like to do is we'd like to understand how the world is changing here, we'd like to move here and get a telescope into the future. And one of the things I'm excited about for the science now is that we have this telescope in the form of really new types of models which are able for the first time to really connect the small scales using the equations of motion that we know here or in the deep tropics here to the very large scales in the storms here. And this is something that's completely new in the field, is our ability to do realistic climate simulations in a way that coherently represent the entirety or the entirety of the scales that I've been talking about in this lecture. And so for me, it's a really exciting time as a climate scientist because we're developing the tools that might give us an idea of what type of future we're walking into. And we might not have to be like the blindfolded girl walking to North Europe to see the breaking of the dikes and the flooding of society. And so with that, I'll conclude. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Bjorn, again. And so now we can go to the next part of the meeting, and I think we can call all the speakers. You can sit here in your where the name is. So, and then I think both of the three of us also will sit, and Adrian will start asking the questions. So
we actually had 25 questions submitted, so we definitely won't be able to go through all of them. So Michaela and I have been sifting through. And Michaela here, I want to introduce, she's a professor from Le Monde, Michaela Biasuti, and she's going to be leading the question session for us. So I just want to thank you very much for that. I shall sit down there. Do you want me to sit next to you?
I think I'm okay. I just need to make it bigger. Okay. First of all, thank everybody for their great talks. So here we have a few questions that are about the science and a few that are about, you know, solutions. So let's start with the science. And for Sandrine, how is it possible to disentangle the uncertainties resulting from cloud processes from all the other processes that are poorly represented in models? And the person making the question was referring, for example, to turbulence. I could think of many more. So do you can you comment on that? And,
yeah. But can you hear me? Yes? No? Yes. Good. So that's a good question. Clouds are connected to so many processes that it's difficult to really disentangle all the different processes, and actually, yeah, turbulence is part of cloud processes, so it's not something distinct. The way we try to disentangle the different processes at work is by using a spectrum or hierarchy of models of different complexities. So we try to simplify models as much as we can. Sometimes we remove some
representations of some particular processes so that it's a way to assess whether this process plays a role or not. So it's really by working with a hierarchy of models, sometimes going up to conceptual models, that we can try to put a hierarchy among the roles of the different processes.
Should I repeat everything? Or that's
yes,
okay.
Maybe, yes.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Maybe you want to add to that.
So there's another question about, for Kerry especially, about the fat tail risks. And if you can give a little bit more of an explanation for how these events behave, and whether, and the end point is whether you really think that they pose an existential threat to human civilization. I guess that picture of a human viability was pretty scary. So do you really think we are in the presence of a climate crisis?
I think those of us who study the climate system rapidly become humbled by what we don't know about it. There's an awful lot of uncertainty in this, and we look at our own knowledge of the climate system. We look at it when we translate it into the human questions of human well-being, it becomes a problem of risk, and it should be thought of that way. And we have to be aware of the known unknowns and the unknown unknowns of this. The basic problem we have is that human society has become finally adapted to a climate which has been uniquely, almost uniquely stable in Earth's climate history for the last 7,000 years. It's not a coincidence, I think, that human civilization developed coincident with the onset of a very stable climate. If you change that climate a little bit, whether it's cooling or warming, actually probably doesn't matter from this point of view, you disrupt civilization. It's not catastrophic for the planet. The planet has dealt with climate change before. It's a question of whether our civilization can adapt to this change, which is probably unprecedented in the history of human civilization. That remains to be seen.
Anybody else wants to comment on that? Then Bjorn, one's for you. Some claim that the IPCC reports are reticent, that they do not take into account feedback mechanisms and fat tail risks. Is it true? And can you give some clarification about this? What's your opinion?
Maybe reticent is a bit of a pejorative. I think what the IPCC reports do, and those in the room who have been involved as well would attest to that, Sandrine was on some, and Steve and other people here have been involved, is it really tries to find a way to say, what are the things that we're pretty sure about? And when you talk about the fat tails, those are the things that we're not very sure about. And it's easy to speculate. And I think what Kerry said, I would just echo, is that the thing that actually that worries me about climate change isn't the things that I know about. It's the, you know, it's that girl moving to the northern edge of the continent to terra incognita. And we know that as we drive our world into a condition that we haven't really experienced as a human society, we're going to have the same sort of surprises as the Frieslanders had when the storms rose up. What they'll be and where they'll happen, we don't know about. But and maybe we'll get lucky. You know, there's examples of migrations where people went to terra incognita and they were pretty happy. And maybe things didn't. So we can't rule out the fact that we'll be lucky. But there's a lot of things that we don't know, and I don't really see the utility of IPCC speculating about all these things. I think people can understand that as we move to a new world, things will happen that we didn't anticipate. But they don't need to scare the people. Our job as scientists isn't to try to scare the people into action. And yeah, so I would say they're reticent for a good reason.
My take is a little bit different. I think as a scientist, we have an obligation, if you don't mind me putting it this way, to paint the entire probability distribution. where the width of that distribution reflects our uncertainty. And then decision makers can deal with that information, but I think we would be remiss not to look at the tails as far as we understand them in that distribution. Maybe translating those tales into some horror story for civilization, that we shouldn't do. I agree with Bjorn about that. But, you know, what are the, you know, low probability but high impact climate changes that could occur within the realm of our current understanding? I think we have to do that. Yeah.
We do, but we have to do it symmetrically as well. Yes. You know, and the danger often is that as a climate science community, we're a little bit more encouraged to talk about the bad surprises. Yeah, so once we get in the realm of speculating, then there could be some good surprises. I don't know what they are. I'm not saying that that we should look forward to them. But that's always the hard part there, is to do that in a symmetric way.
Yeah, great.
So a good follow-up would be, was a question about what are the uncertainties, you know, associated with, in particular, the storm damage probability density function that you show, Kerry. Can you comment on that more?
Yeah, you know, it's a very interesting thing with hurricanes that it's a little bit of a counterexample in a funny way to what we were just talking about, that we're more confident about what happens to the tails of the distribution than we are to the center of the distribution. It's just the way the physics of it works out. It's a capped distribution. We understand how that limiting intensity changes reasonably well, assuming we understand what the rest of the climate's doing, of course. And so we sort of can predict things near that cap better than we can predict the center. How confident are we in it? Not terribly. I think if you look at the report that we've just written collectively, it's very straightforward about the uncertainties. But it does say that we should be and arguably are experiencing an increase in the intensity of extreme events, both in rain and wind. And what happens to the center of the distribution, oddly enough for that particular phenomenon, that's where the uncertainty lies. Fortunately, where it doesn't matter as much. But in other phenomena, we're not so fortunate as that.
So, let's stay on the theme of uncertainty, and then maybe think about the possible tail and distribution for climate sensitivity. So Sandrine, you've talked about the role of clouds. And so somebody was asking, you know, in the role of observations and contrasting and using together observations and models. So the question is, would it be valid to look at observations and try to measure cloud and other climate feedbacks directly from today's climate? And would that be helpful in reducing the uncertainties that we see in models and in model sensitivity?
Well, that's something that we'd love to do, and actually there have been many attempts to do that already. But what the climate sensitivity estimates that we can make based on the historical record, for instance, does not fit with the, well, it's not directly related to the climate sensitivity that corresponds to the long-term response to global warming. And for a long term, we thought that there was really a mismatch in our understanding and maybe a mismatch in the models. And now we understand a bit better why there is such an inconsistency. And it's because it turns out that the climate sensitivity depends on the special patterns of surface temperatures. And this pattern depends on many factors. It depends on variability, internal variability of climate and so on. And it doesn't change in the same way in the past that it will change in the future. And that affects climate sensitivity. So now we know that we cannot directly estimate climate sensitivity from the past record. It's been looked at a lot. And there's still there's a lot of literature about this. But it's not as simple as that.
So maybe you can explain a little bit more how you're going to use the observations of the next campaign to bridge that gap. So observations not of trends, but of processes.
Well, there are different ways in which you can use observations to constrain climate sensitivity. Either you can try to estimate climate sensitivity directly from global observations. And as I just explained, it's not straightforward to do that. But on the other hand, you can use observations to better understand the physical processes the individual processes that really controls a long-term response. And if we think of cloud feedbacks, we know that the response of trade cumuli is very sensitive for climate sensitivity. It explains a large part of the spread of climate sensitivity estimates among the models. So we'd like to test whether the different models and represent the key physics that control this cloud. And that's where observations at the process level really can help us test the realism of the representations of these clouds in models. So here we'll look at processes at very short time scales and in a very detailed way, but it will be a way to test really our physical understanding of how these clouds form, what controls their properties and so on. And it will not be enough to test global feedbacks, but it's certainly a necessary condition to be confident in what the same models will do in the future for this cloud. In addition, if you analyze cloud feedbacks, there are a few things we know that are important for cloud feedbacks that depend on what the models are doing in the present day climate. And in terms of cloud feedbacks, we know, for instance, that an important controlling factor of the low cloud feedback is the strength of the mixing of water vapor in the lower troposphere in the present day climate. And so that's something that we can try to quantify based on observations and based on field campaign observations, for instance. So it's indirect. The way you can use observations to constrain what will happen in the future is necessarily indirect. We don't have observations of the future. But we try to design the route based on our physical understanding of what might be important. It's an iterative process, very much based on physical understanding.
Because, you know, one of the important points that came up was this idea that the temperatures have been changing in the past, which isn't representative of the way that they change in the future. But that's sort of a hypothesis. I mean, one of the curious things now is that we're trying to explain the fact that the Earth hasn't warmed as much as we would have thought by the fact that the pattern of warming was one that acted to sort of be a bit of a break on the warming. And the hypothesis then is that won't happen. That won't continue to happen in the future. But to me, that's sort of one of the big unknowns right now, is whether or not the past is precedent or not. And I don't know if you had any thoughts on that, because you were saying the past warming versus the future warming. So do you think the past is unrepresentative of the future or not necessarily representative of the future?
Well, yeah, at least if you ask the question to the same models, do things differently in the past and in the future, and they use the same physics. So that's an argument to say that the past is not necessarily representative of the future.
But our model is it's amazing how similar the pattern of 20th century warming is to the pattern of the future warming. So when we look at the pattern of warming, and so that might be just the MPI model. The spatial pattern of the warming in the past is a wonderful predictor of the spatial pattern of warming in the future, in a way that I find a bit startling. But I think yours has
Let's
the same case.
Let's not get too technical into this, but I'll keep the microphone though, Bjorn, because I wanted to ask you then, as we are talking about new models and sensitivity, somebody was mentioning that the next set of climate models, have the CIMIP-6 coming up, have maybe improved, certainly different cloud and aerosol schemes. And they seem to have a higher climate sensitivity. So are they to be believed?
Are they what?
Are they to be believed? Is climate sensitivity...
We're not higher? In church here. It's not about believing. The problem I have, and we'll talk a little bit of this in the workshop tomorrow, the problem I have with this way of doing things is that question often comes up, do we believe the models? And that's a really embarrassing question for a group of physicists, because the models should be leading us to form hypotheses or physical arguments that we can then test. And unfortunately, we're in this very difficult situation where somehow we've given over authority of the field to activities like CMIP6, where in the end you just hope that you can, you know, filter out some useful information from all these models, and then you ask, do you believe them? And so the answer is no. And until there's a good argument as to why a model has a high climate sensitivity, then I don't really think it's worth paying attention to.
I would just add to that that I think the public believes that what we regard as a problem is based upon observations and very large models. And if what we believed were based on very large models, I wouldn't, quote-unquote, believe it either, because models are believed when they're tested rigorously against observations. And we can do that to some extent for the past climate, so I agree with that. But Sandrine herself has pointed out, and I was part of that effort, that a lot of what we know about the climate is based upon just plain theory. Going back more than 100 years, Svante Arrhenius, who was the first to predict that doubling CO2 would increase the temperature, and he got it about consistent with modern estimates, no big models. The Charney report, the first report to the American or the National Academy of Science in the U.S., very comprehensive, made estimates of both the expected change and the uncertainty very consistent with today, based mostly upon theory and simple models. So we have, a pretty robust understanding of how we expect the climate change, including the range of uncertainty in certain metrics, but we rely upon the global models to try to fill in details, the spatial patterns of variability and so forth. Do you think that's fair? And so to say that we know nothing because models are complicated is to ignore the fact that our information is based on much more than large, complicated models. And I don't mean to denigrate the models, by the way, at all. They're very consistent, I would say, with our theoretical understanding.
I can add to that. I fully agree with that. That sometimes we think that our climate models have huge limitations and problems. We know that. And because of those limitations, they cannot say anything relevant about future climate. And that's completely wrong appreciation of how we improve our physical and our understanding of climate change and how we can assess the effects of greenhouse gas, for instance, on climate, which is, if I take again the analogy of the puzzle that I was showing in my talk, our understanding of climate change is really a puzzle, and there are pieces which are already placed in the puzzle that come from very early studies that have been done with conceptual models, very idealized models, simple models, and many of those pieces were put in the puzzle several decades ago, at the time of the Charney report already. And now we are trying to put more and more pieces in the puzzle, and some of them come from GCMs, from the climate models, but they can come from many other sources of evidence. They come from observations, they come from new generation of models like those that Bjorn was showing. And it's really by combining all the sources of information and all this evidence that little by little we improve our physical understanding of what's going on. But we should never think that our understanding or of climate change comes directly from a climate model. Certainly it's not the case.
Yes, absolutely.
Advantage of being here. So it's interesting that you have all this comments about how much we know, how much we don't know. And that progress has been made over the years over more observation, more data, better models. But can you foresee a breakthrough at some point? When will you think the field can make a breakthrough that something may happen in a few years' time where you can see, oh, this will make the field much, much more solid, much more under control? Or seeing the other way around, you have unlimited resources, what do you think we should be doing in this field? So theoretically and observationally, to the three of you.
Can start the answer and maybe you can follow on. So the breakthrough can come from new tools, and I think that the type of new models that Bjorn was showing at the end of his talk that really connect the small scales to the large scales are really completely new. And so that's really a large opportunity for progress here. The other source of progress, I think, is in the way we tackle problems, and sometimes tackling very old problems through a completely new angle can lead to very fast progress. And I think what's going on in the area of convective organization, for instance, is a very good example of that. Kerry has been studying hurricanes for many decades, and many other people have been trying to understand how what the physics of hurricanes and how they might react to different perturbations. And now with this topic, and we realize that convection can, or clouds can spontaneously organize, the atmosphere can spontaneously organize in wet and dry areas, and if you have rotation that can create hurricanes and so on. It's a completely new way of tackling an old problem. And in a way, it gives you a simpler way to understand how things work. So sometimes conceptual ideas can really lead to breakthrough. Maybe you want to do it, to say it in a better way.
No. I just want to echo you, Sandrine. I think, you know, one of the problems for our field, climate science, is that it, in my opinion, too much of it has been given over to this practical problem of can we predict the climate? And yet, if there were to be a breakthrough, and I'm no position to predict that, it would come from the sorts of things Sandrine was talking about. We need to restore the curiosity-driven basic science focus of climate science. We need to take brilliant young physics students, for example, and get them interested in the intellectual content of our field. I mean, we discovered this self-aggregation, which is the subject of this workshop, because people were really interested in how convection worked on a small scale. They weren't interested when they were doing this. I'm almost certain they weren't interested in the climate problem when they were doing this. They happened upon it through curiosity-driven research, and it's turning out to be important. We need more of that.
Your question presupposed if one was going to spend a lot of money. So I would fully agree with Kerry that we need to reestablish the curiosity-driven science. To do that, we have to change the culture. And in climate science, it's a bit difficult because we have a somewhat poisonous culture in the sense that for decades, we've only been allowed to really talk openly about what we know. And we have to keep reinforcing what we know because dishonest people try to misuse expressions of doubt about a few things to caricature doubt about everything. And so unlike many other fields, we have found it more difficult to talk about the things that we don't know. And there's many things we don't know, and they're really fascinating and cool, and it's so much more fun to talk about them. And that's how you motivate people to come into the field. Who wants to come to a field where we've known everything for 20 years and, you know, we're just filling in details? And so we all struggle with this, is how do we communicate the things that we don't know, because that's what draws people to the field. But if you're going to spend money, you can spend money on doing some things right. The way we treat the modeling is amateurist. The way we treat the global observing system is amateurist. For something as important as climate, that we don't have a more coordinated global observing system. The fact that we can measure gravity waves, you know, 10 to the minus, it's like 23 orders of magnitude that we spanned over the decades to make that, I mean, real gravity waves, gravitational waves, to make that measurement. And if you look at what we've done in terms of the energy budget in the atmosphere, CO2 doubling is 3 to 4 watts, and the precision of, you know, our ability to make the measurement is 6 watts. So why can't we get an order of magnitude there by a concerted effort to track the energy flow in the system much better? But that would be something someone could spend money on if they wanted to spend money. Here, catch.
Well, there's a lot of public debate about the climate change and so on. Now, at this point in time, what is your message to the policymakers? Because politicians would like to know exactly how they should behave, especially in the U.S., as everybody knows that the Trump administration pull out of the Paris Accords. So as a scientist, you know what you are doing, but at this point in time, what is your message to the policymakers?
I don't really have one. I think I would have the message for you guys is vote. And influence, you know, that's our own individual decisions, but people, I think climate's an important problem and people should reflect that in who they vote for and what's important for them when they vote. And I kind of like to think that the policymakers will ultimately follow the people if the people demand it. And I guess, you know, that would be more up to you guys.
Well, I think that the accomplishments of the field of climate science amply demonstrate that the level of risk we're incurring to future generations is enough to warrant some kind of action. It's not enough to warrant the destruction of global economy, but everything we understand about energy is a totally different field from ours. I happen to be involved in it at MIT, is that it won't be that difficult to solve the problem from the point of view of at least curtailing carbon emissions. It's a question there. And I think, frankly, I think the message is much more effectively to come from young people across the board than it is from climate scientists like me. But if I were asked, that's what I would tell them.
And personally, if there was one thing I'd like to tell the policy people is that the science of climate change is not done, as it is sometimes thought in some arenas. It's not because there are a few questions which have been solved by climate scientists that all of the questions are solved. And if we want to guide adaptation and mitigation policies, certainly we need to understand much more than we currently understand about climate, how the climate works. And so it's a plea for research.
So I think we are running out of time. I have one more question that I think kind of ties things together, both in terms of connecting to the new generation and how they can be advocates and how they can maybe get excited about the field. And so somebody was asking, do you think we need to reframe the science curriculum and rethink how science is taught in school to maybe including climate education? And also, can participatory community projects with schools can help in building this field and this advocacy, maybe even?
For all three of us. the question is, you know, how can we tackle this problem? How can young people get involved in it and so forth? And it's, educators. We're not, in the United States, and I come from, it's fair to say, a world-class technical institute, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. I can tell you that 95% of the undergraduates graduate from MIT with essentially no knowledge of climate science. There's no emphasis on it. A few physics courses touch on it. We try in my department to teach it, but we get almost no enrollment because the institution doesn't emphasize the problem. So there's a big problem there. It's complicated. I mean, MIT is being funded by, among other things, some very wealthy people who would just as soon not deal with the climate problem or wish it would just go away. So it's complicated, and that's maybe US-centric problem, okay? But I think that if young physics-oriented students understood or could be made to understand simply that this is a really intellectually exciting field. Forget about global warming. If there wasn't any such thing, it would still be a very vibrant, very, very motivating field. If they only knew, I think we would get more talent working in this field, and that couldn't hurt at all.
Yeah, go for it.
I struggle with when we go to education and how to outreach, I struggle with the fact that for me, climate change is such a manifestation of what some people like to call the Anthropocene. And for me, the way I like to think of the Anthropocene is the fact that that humans have the ability to affect the globe,
but we don't have ways to regulate that behavior. So there's a bit of a crisis in our on the scales on which we can govern and regulate behavior. And that I don't know how we solve that, because to me, the problems of poverty and inequality and wealth distribution are exactly the same thing. They're the problem where we cause instabilities in the system to be expressed in ways that we don't know how to manage. And so figuring out this problem, I think, will be key to humanity in a lot of ways. It won't be just key for climate. It will be key for distribution of resources and equality and wealth and parity in many different ways. And so I don't know how to separate climate from that. And if we do that in education, it seems to me it's missing the boat, because the boat is really this inability to regulate ourselves globally, but we have things that act globally.
Well, I can just mention something that happened recently in France. Some people have been fighting very strongly to introduce a few things about climate and climate change in curriculum and in primary school and up to high schools. And the Minister of Education, the Ministry of the Education, was very reluctant to do it. And they finally changed their mind very recently, and these topics will be addressed at least in high school. And it's because there were big protests for climate from young people in the streets during the last month. So.
All right. Do you want to conclude the? Yes.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Michaela. So, well, thank you all for such a wonderful presentations and debate, which I think is very much appreciated by everybody here. So before we finish, I wanted to usually we have a colloquium, and there are some refreshments outside, and we usually ask the students to come here and talk to the speakers. However, I know I don't want to abuse of the time of the speakers, and you may be very tired. So Adrian proposed that the students can come and talk to the speakers, but at the same time you're having refreshments. So at the same time, everybody benefit. So let's be original this time, and please join me to thank all the speakers again. Thank you.